Okay, so we'll start up right now. So, hey, I'm Major General Dan Hughes. I'm the Program Executive Officer for Command Control Communications Tactical. Today, I want to talk to you about the Tactical Network. And before I start up right now, we're going to show a little bit of a video, and then we'll get into a few slides and then answer whatever questions that you have, except for Scott's questions, which we'll pass on. How's that sound, Scott? All right, super.
Today, the Army Network is providing secure and reliable communication with the overseas operations, but the network is not a static effort. And as our enemies pursue new communication and cyber capabilities, the Army is continuing to incrementally modernize our network to retain overmatch.
If you can talk more effectively throughout the battlefield, it just makes everyone's job that much easier. It gives the commanders the flexibility to push their orders down. It makes them aware of what the battlefield looks like and where their soldiers are in the current situation out on the battlefield.
There's no differences when operating these systems, specifically the mounted platforms, between capabilities that we have inside our command posts and capabilities that we have when operating in austere environments.
In 2015, 75 active, reserve, and Army National Guard units are scheduled to receive tactical network upgrades through capability set and unit set fielding efforts. This includes the first Stryker units to be fielded with advanced network capability sets.
We very rarely stay in the same place for very long, especially in the current fight we're in. We're always moving from point A to point B. It's the ability to talk while moving just enables us to cover more ground when we have comms.
Fielding updated equipment to the Guard is especially important, allowing units to communicate seamlessly not only with active component forces, but also with local first responders during emergencies. Through continued fielding and phased modernization, the network will remain ready to support an expeditionary, agile, and globally responsive force to win in a complex world.
So I think we got our win in a complex world in, so we have to have that up front. That's our prim. So today I'm going to talk to you again about our tactical network, and I'll tell you, one of the current things that you will hear is how do we make things expeditionary? How do we link things together? How do we have an internet of things that we can have across the spectrum so we can provide the warfighter at the pointy edge of the sword the capability they need, get the knowledge to them when they need it and the volume that they need it. Right now, when you pull out your iPhone, you click on an app, you expect it to work. You expect to see something. You expect your Google Maps to get you somewhere. And if you type in Monroe Street here, you actually end up the other end of Monroe Street, and you don't end up at the hotel. I just want to say that up front because my wife Kathy was sitting there last night. But that said, we're going to try to provide, or are providing, that capability from home station all the way through. If you're taking a picture of that instead of me, Scott. Okay. Home station all the way through an in-route mission where you get on an aircraft, all the way to the ground, and then you build up comms as you get on the ground, wherever you're at, whether you're doing a mission there, or they're doing security there, whether you're doing some sort of operation. So we're trying to provide comms all the way there. We're working with the G6 of the Army to make sure our networks are linked. So a tactical network that does not have the ability to talk to the enterprise network is something that we cannot afford anymore. We cannot have an isolated network in each piece. We need to have a holistic network. Again, as you pick up your iPhone, you click on an app, you go back to a server. If you're at Verizon, go to a server in Ashburn, Virginia, and it connects to that server. It allows you to do a whole bunch of things. All that data store is stored somewhere in what we call the cloud. So think about what we have to do to enable that tactical soldier on the ground to have that capability and how we put that entire internet together. So we're going to talk more about today is how we are building that and where we are at. And when I say next slide, I'll just click my finger. How's that sound? Ah, there you go. I'm sorry. Go back. You got it? Okay. All right. So right now, your Army Tactical Network is deployed worldwide from Afghanistan to supporting Ebola, to supporting Operation Atlantic Resolve, to doing multiple networks across the world and linking back to the home station for all of that connectivity that we need for our warfighters. That tactical network today works. We are enhancing it at every opportunity we can with the great investments that Congress gives us and that our PMs can execute to make sure we put the best equipment in the hands of our soldiers as we go forward. It's great stories are our young soldiers taking the equipment we give them, using it in ways that we never thought they would use it to get the mission done where they are at. Critical, critical support. But of course, you guys understand that changes every day. The IT world is the fastest changing thing we have. Every 18 months, we get newer processors. Every capability gets faster and better. Everyone needs more bandwidth. I mean, every single time. It's like my kids at home, if Netflix doesn't work, Dad hears about it. So that's the critical. That's the soldier that we're getting today who believes that they deserve and they demand an internet that works. That's what we're trying to do and trying to put in their hands to execute the fight. The video talked about, and before I go into this, the video talked about some of the things we're doing across the entire Army. So it's not just the active force. We just upgraded the Maryland National Guard's capability and quadrupled the capability they have at the division to pull information down and to be linked seamlessly into that network. The more we do that, the more they'll be able to respond not only to the national missions that they get, but also the state missions that they have. So we are equipping the entire force to be responsive to whatever the nation needs them to be. These fieldings, as we said in the film, there are 75 fieldings going on this year. We focus normally on our capability sets, one brigade here and another brigade here. That's not what happens. We are fielding continuously, upgrading systems as we go along. It's as if you have, and I don't know who has Verizon Fios in their house, but I just got a new router. That router gets updated every single night. We need to absolutely update these systems on a regular basis. My kids go through cell phones pretty quickly. I don't know. Me, not so much. Them, every year they get a new cell phone and Merry Christmas every year. But critically, keeping that information technology up to date is something that the Army is investing very heavily in making that happen. Looking for leap ahead technologies, and I think if you haven't sat with General Charlton and the guys with the NIE, probably listen to what they're trying to do at the NIE so we can enhance the network and enhance our capability on a regular basis. What's up here right now are the fielding quantities that we have, and I want to go through all the details and numbers, but the Army is a volume business. The Army is the biggest service. The Army, when we talk about how many radios a brigade combat team has, it's in the thousands. So think about what we have. Stan Nemec is back here. Stan, where are you? All right. Stan does ComSec for us. Stan deals in the hundreds of thousands of items. It's a big, big math problem that we're dealing with. When you need to upgrade, when you need to keep those things cyber secure, when you need to make sure you train them, we are talking about big volume. So this is a large enterprise, and every chance we get to make it better, to do better on the fielding, to make sure that these systems are affordable, we do it. We use every dollar the taxpayer gives us to get the best capability that we possibly can. Just to identify where those 75 fieldings are, across the Army, across the spectrum, across the world, as we have folks right now, to include all our FSRs that are downrange in multiple countries, making sure the equipment works, making sure soldiers are trained, and making sure that our warfighters have the greatest capability that we can give them. One of the key systems that we have in the Army is called the Joint Battle Command Platform. You guys have heard of Blue Force Tracking. The Blue Force Tracking piece of this, with Joint Battle Command software on top of it, provides a capability that we have never had in the field before. We have actually had this unit turn to us, the 3rd ID, and say, you know what, can you cut our net training down because this is pretty easy to use. So if you haven't heard me speak before, Stan, have I say simplicity more often than... Where's Jim Ross? Simple Jim? There you go. So what we have done with this system is we have made it as easy to use as possible. What model I like to use is the iPhone. I hate to give Apple so much credit, guys, but when you pick up an iPhone, how often do you go to an iPhone training course when you get one? Anybody been to an iPhone training course? Ross, put your hand down. We want to make our systems that simple to use. They're intuitive, they're easy to use, they're easy to upgrade, they're cyber secure, and we make it so that the soldier is fighting the fight, not having to mess with the equipment to get the equipment to work. You have to be able to do that, and I think we are making great strides. When we took this piece of equipment for the first unit equipped, that's what FUE means, down in the third ID, that unit adopted the equipment as theirs, and that brigade commander looked me in the eye a couple of weeks ago and said, I'm not going to war without this piece of kit because it's what I need to fight the fight. It gives me situation awareness. I know where my soldiers are at. I can execute my mission. This is key for us as we go forward. That's a great piece of kit that we're giving our soldiers. We'll be fielding to the rest of the Army here as we get through the last pieces of our equipping strategy. So I talked about a little bit the lessons learned on putting the network together. So someone asked me this morning, how long have we been putting the network together? And so I'll tell you just a quick story. So when I was a battery commander, and it feels like 100 years ago, but in about 1988, 89, I took my father, who's a World War II and Korea soldier, brought him to my firing battery. He looked at me and he said, you know, Dan, that howitzer is incredible. I'm an artilleryman. That howitzer is incredible. What a great piece of kit. I wish we would have had that, not what we had in World War II. Gosh, we could have used that. Well, I showed him all the 50 cals I had. Great piece of equipment. Always loved it, that capability. Showed him the other track vehicles we had. Then I brought him inside the fire direction center, and he goes, that damn radio, we couldn't even get it to work in Korea. That was 30 years different. Now, it wasn't the same radio. It sure looked like it, but it was not the same radio. We absolutely, positively can't fall behind on that IT piece. We also need to make sure that every bit of kit that we get gets upgraded, is upgradable, is easy to use, and the simplicity is built into each one of those pieces that we bring forward. One of the again, I talked about it a little earlier, the key pieces of making our soldiers adopt this equipment is to make sure that the interface not only is easy to use, but it doesn't change all the time. So when I go into my Mac and I click on something, you know, Word or something, it looks like Word. Now, I don't know what Microsoft did with Windows 8. You guys, whoever has that, good luck. But I don't see a big difference. You can't change that interface because it's a training issue. As I talked earlier on, the Army has a volume issue. So if I change an interface and I go and train hundreds of thousands of soldiers as they deploy back and forth, or train them to go to the rotations at the National Training Center or somewhere, it becomes a huge issue and it costs the taxpayers a lot of money. We can't afford to do that. Field support realignment. What we did is we took a lot of great equipment over the last 14 years, brought it down range, put it in the hands of soldiers, and had to have support with it to run the equipment. There are a lot of great Americans that went down and did that. A lot of great folks. There's nothing negative about what they did, but you know what? It's very expensive to do that way. So we need to, and what we have taken on, especially in PEOC3T, is the reduction of support for these systems. Now, if you can make the system intuitive from the very beginning, you do reduce that overhead that you have. But if you have to put something down range, it's a little less intuitive. You need to put support there. What we're trying to do, and we're working with our CECOM buddies, and Colonel Schroeder is out there, and his team at Toby Hand has helped us a lot with this, is to develop these multifunctional field support representatives that allow us to have less of a footprint on the ground and maintain the service that we provide across there, because soldiers need their equipment to work. System-to-system training is another piece. So we can have in isolation 18 different systems. If they do not work together, the commander does not get a common operational picture. One of the biggest things we need is a common understanding across the battlefield so the commander knows and can predict what's going on in the battlefield. So we're looking at our system-to-system training. So if I give each system in isolation and we do not train them together, the systems will not work together. So it's critical for us to do that. We have taken that on, and we're seeing the fruits of that in units that are going now to the National Training Center and to the other rotations that we have, where they walk in the door with a system-to-system approach so we can execute their fight from day one. We do not want to have a training or a learning curve as you deploy. So what we're doing on the in-route piece is that we get an internet at home station, we get an internet where you're kind of connected on in-route, and then you get the same connectivity as you go through the entire cycle of a deployment. That's critical for us to make sure that we can provide that warfighting capability at every aspect. So, before we go to questions real quick, I've sat in these vehicles on multiple occasions. I am 5'8", I weigh 165 pounds, so I weigh 168 after last night's dinner. But I'm not a big guy. There are a lot of folks that are a lot bigger than I am. And when they fit inside these vehicles with all of the stuff, sir, how are you? I mentioned Enterprise Network at least once. General Farrell has just joined us here. And sir, you can pass through and so I can finish. Did I say how important the Enterprise Network was? Let me mention that one more. There he goes. Okay, let's stop that. But fitting all of this kit inside the vehicles we have is a big deal. Take a look at what we have here, all of the equipment on top, all the antennas on top, all the integration that has to go into the engineering that makes this stuff work together. During the last 15 years, we have handed a lot of units a lot of things, and they have had to do a lot of integration by themselves. We're not doing that. We're working with Scott Davis, and Dave Bassett was up here talking about the AMV yesterday, to make sure that these are integrated packages before they go into the vehicles, eliminating what we do not need, making sure we spend every dollar the taxpayer gives us on the equipment we absolutely need to make sure that this stuff works together. Now with that, I haven't taken that much time. I will open it to your questions, except for Scott. I know you got